Friends, welcome to GYS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So as you know, friends, that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and on this channel we will cover your entire syllabus from static as well as current point of view. And the first topic that we have picked up is the environment and ecology. So already we have covered its 12 lectures, and today we are going to cover its 13th lecture. So the students who are new to the channel are requested to first see the 12 videos that I have posted on my YouTube channel, so that you can come in continuity with the lecture number 13. So the old students should now concentrate on the lecture. Let's start, friends. Lecture number 13 is on estuaries and mangroves. So today we are going to cover the estuaries as well as mangroves. So what are estuaries, friends? See, these are the systems where fresh water of river meets the salty water of the ocean. So if you have seen the coastal areas, so in coastal areas the river meets the ocean, and similarly the oceanic water meets the river water. So the zone of transition where the river water meets fresh river water meets with the oceanic sea water, salty sea water, is called estuary. So estuary has the salinity between the freshwater ecosystem as well as the marine water ecosystem. So these are complex ecosystems because they have high productivity. So friends, why they have high productivity? Because they receive high amount of nutrients from fresh as well as marine water. So if you see the coastline of India, so suppose here the river is falling into the sea, into the Bay of Bengal, and here the oceanic water is intermixed here with fresh river water, then this zone will constitute the estuary. So these are complex ecosystems, as they receive the nutrients from both the fresh water as well as marine water. So the mixing of fresh water and sea water creates a brackish environment. So earlier, friends, in my previous lectures I told you that what is a brackish environment. The brackish environment is that environment which has the salinity in between the fresh water ecosystem and the marine water ecosystem, where and in brackish water ecosystem, in this type of brackish water ecosystem, the salinity will be highest near the ocean, near to the sea, and lowest near to the freshwater river. You might be able to understand this because it is a simple logic, that because when the fresh water is added into the marine water, then the salinity will obviously be low at the point of the at the point where the rivers enter the sea water. So friends, estuaries harbor a unique plant and animal communities. Why they harbor unique plant and animal communities? Because the water is brackish. So particular unique type of species are needed in the are adaptable to these type of ecosystems, which can tolerate the saline environment of these ecosystems, these estuaries. So these estuaries function both on planktonic based and detritus based food webs. So friends, we have already covered the concept of food webs. So food webs are of two types, food chains are of two types, that is planktonic based and detritus based. So here they follow both. So the students who don't know what are these planktonic based and detritus based food webs, please see my previous videos. See friends, these estuaries provide a calm refuge from open sea. So friends, you know that in oceans lot of water activity takes place. We can say that waves are sometimes very, 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 very much strong. So the open sea is not that much calm, whereas the estuaries are calm as compared to open sea. So they provide a calm refuge, and that's why they provide shelter to various marine species that have to breed or nest in such places. So an estuary is formed where a river or stream runs into the sea, forming a transition zone between fresh water and fresh water and salt water. So already I explained you this concept. So friends, banks of estuaries channels form a favored location for human settlements. You can see the lot of human settlements coming around the estuaries, which use these estuaries for the commercial purposes like fishing and aquaculture, agriculture, etc. So friends, the most vivid example is of New York City. The New York City, with a population of more than 8 million people, is an example of major urban area that is located around an estuary. So these are favored locations. Next friends, next what they do is they act as a filter for some dissolved constituents in river water. So when the river water comes, it falls into the sea water. It contains some constituents in the dissolved form. So estuaries help in filtering those dissolved constituents, as well as it traps the suspended mud and the sand carried by the rivers that has come from the mountainous areas, flowing all along the way into the sea water. So it contains mud and sand, and these estuaries trap this mud and sand in themselves, and they lead to the formation of deltas. So next friends comes the you might be knowing the definition of delta. Delta delta forms when the river deposits the sediments carried by it. So the sediments when deposited constitute the delta of a river. So next come friends, what is now from India's perspective, most of the India's major estuaries occur on the east coast. So friends, this is India, this is our west coast, and this is our east coast. I am expecting that you know the directions. So you are preparing for IAS, you must be knowing about these directions: north, south, east and west. So most of our estuaries are on the east coast. Very low are in the west coast. So friends, the Chilka Lake is one of the most beautiful estuaries in India. Many estuaries are locations of some of the major seaports in India. So the major seaports that we see on the east coast are the locations are in a sense they are located on estuaries. So next comes the benefits of estuaries. What is the benefit of estuarine ecosystem, friends? Water quality regulation. So I told you earlier that they help in the filtering of dissolved constituents that are contained by the river water. So they help in water regulation as well as groundwater recharge. They provide habitat to certain marine and terrestrial organisms. They provide the breeding grounds and nursery grounds. Why, friends, breeding and nursery grounds? Because they provide a calm refuge from the seawater, open seawater, which is very turbulent. Next is the biological productivity. The biological productivity of estuarine ecosystem is high because they harbor a unique type of plant and animal species which are tolerant to the saline environment. Friends, they also provide knowledge and research value. And next is the economic benefits. So how they provide economic benefits? By commercial fishing, by agriculture, by aquaculture, by harbor facilities in the ports, through the service of navigation and all these. But they also provide recreation as well as agriculture, aquaculture and industry that we have covered in the economic benefits. Also friends, they provide the storm and erosion protection. So friends, if you see here India's coastline, so if the seawater is coming here close to the coastline, then it will do its work. It will try to erode the coastal areas, and also if the wave is fast, then it will inundate the inland areas and will flood the inland areas. So what is the function of ecosystem? It protects inland from the storm and the coastal areas from erosion, because they form a buffer between the actions of the coastal seawater waves and these coastal boundaries. So next is the issues faced by Indian estuaries. So friends, we have covered in detail the wetlands and the issues faced by wetlands. The similar issues that are faced by wetlands are the issues that are faced by estuaries. So friends, some major issues I have included is like water flow. In some estuaries the water flow is so much, and in some estuaries the water is very less amount, which affects the ecosystem of these estuaries. Next is the friends pollution from industrial waste or municipal waste discharge. So I told you earlier that a number of cities are coming across these estuaries. So they discharge their municipal waste and are affecting the quality of water there and health of estuaries. Next is the next process is the land reclamation. So friends, these are the areas of no man's land. So in such areas the tendency of the human being is to reclaim the land for the rural purposes, for the rural settlements, urban settlements, or for agriculture or aquaculture purposes. So we are completely destabilizing these estuaries, and we are in the process of destabilizing them. Next friends comes the ports and shipping activities. So the ports and shipping activities which require dredging, the removal of the sediments, the removal of the mud from beneath the surface of the water body, all such activities also affect the estuaries. Next is the overexploitation of resources, for example overfishing and all these. Next friends, next problem is the climate change. So friends, climate is changing and the global warming is taking place, due to which the ice is melting and the sea levels are rising. And when the friends sea levels are rising, then obviously the sea water will inundate the inlands. So the river water which was earlier entering the estuary will not be able to enter, because the sea level has already increased and the sea water will enter into the estuary. The more sea water will be entered into the estuary, so the balanced salinity of the estuary will be ruined in this way, because the sea water will enter in large amount and the rivers will not be able to enter due to this rise in sea level. So this affects the estuaries. Next, this is all about friends estuaries. Next topic is the mangroves. So friends, you might have listened about these mangroves. These are very important from the ecological point of view. So now let's study about them. What are mangroves? So friends, what are mangroves? Mangroves are in a simple definition, they are salt tolerant plants. So the salt tolerant plants which are found in tropical or subtropical intertidal regions of the world are called mangroves. So the term mangroves refer to an ecological group of halophytic plants. So friends, what are halophytic plants? Halophytic plants are those plants which are salt tolerant. So basically the salt tolerant plants which are found in tropical and subtropical areas are called mangroves, but they have certain additional characteristics to be called mangroves. Next friends comes the specific regions where these plants occur are termed as mangrove ecosystems. So where they are occurring are known as mangrove ecosystems. So friends, they are also very sensitive and fragile. So besides mangroves, the ecosystems also harbors other plants and animal species. So friends, it is not the case that if we are calling a particular ecosystem as mangrove ecosystem, then only the mangrove forests are existing there. The other plants will also be there, the other animals may also be there, but the dominant plants are these halophytic subtropical plants called mangroves. So friends, these mangroves are found in intertidal zone. I will explain you in the diagram. Here you can see the diagram. I have included the diagram. This is the diagram. So here it is an intertidal zone. Here is water, and behind it will be terrestrial ecosystem. So it will be these mangroves will be between the terrestrial and the aquatic ecosystem. So they are in a simple sense the ecotones, where the zone of transition, which is the zone of transition. Next one friends, they are found in intertidal zone. They are uniquely adapted to survive in highly saline and anoxic conditions. So the water is saline due to the inundation by the sea water or the ocean water. So water is also saline, and it is not only saline but also anoxic conditions prevail. That means the dissolved oxygen is in very less amount. So they are specially adapted. They have the adaptability to these conditions. For example, some mangroves secret excess salt through their leaves. So the mangroves are surviving in the zones which have high salinity. So in order to survive, they have to survive this salt. So either they release it through their leaves, because their leaves have the special glands which secrete these salt, or they just block the absorption of salts at their roots. So obviously the salt will enter through the roots. So their adaptability will help in reducing the amount of salt absorbed by them through their roots. So this is about their adaptability. Next is friends, they also have another element of adaptability, that is they have viviparity mode of reproduction. So what is this friends? In viviparity mode of reproduction, the seed germinates in tree itself. So if there is a tree here, mangrove tree here, and in the other trees you might have seen that the seed falls over the ground and then it germinates, then the new plant grows. But here in this mangroves, the seed is germinated at the tree itself. Why friends? Why this is the case? Because in the saline conditions, if the seed falls in saline water, then it will not be able to germinate due to the salinity conditions. So they have adapted themselves into the viviparity mode of reproduction, in which the seed germinates itself at the tree at the germinates at the tree itself. So this is an adaptive mechanism to saline water. Next is, friends, mangrove provides invaluable services, for example, but they have been declining worldwide as a result of anthropogenic and other threats. So let's, friends, do what is the significance, importance and benefits of mangrove. So if we see the mangrove ecosystem, it is self-maintaining. It is able to maintain itself. It is self-repairing. If some problem is occurring, it is able to, if problem is occurring to a certain extent, not extreme, not at extreme levels, but to a certain extent, then it is self-repairing and self-sustaining and most productive. They help in the recycling in coast water, recycling of nutrients in coast waters. Also, they help in controlling the pollution through a process called rhizofiltration. So the mangroves perform a special process called rhizofiltration, through which the pollution is controlled. Next comes is, they are source of wood and have unexplored potential for natural products. So they have large amount of wood. So it is a valuable asset for the local communities. Next comes is the mangroves helps to trap debris, silt and stabilizes the coastline. So friends, they have the special ability to trap the debris that is coming that the river has brought with itself downstream. So also it traps the silt and stabilizes the coastline. So how it traps? So friend, you may see here the roots. So these are the particular type of roots called nematophores of the mangroves. So they are type of aerial roots. So they have come from beneath the surface of the earth. So these are type of roots. So in the if there are so many such aerial roots, then they will obviously obstruct the flow of the water. And in this way, when the speed reduces, the sediments that are the debris that is carried by the water is deposited here. So in a way, they help to trap debris, silt and stabilizes the coastline. So in this way they stabilize the coastline, because in this way the erosion will not take place. Also they provide opportunities for education, for scientific research, for ecotourism, for socio-economic studies. So all benefits are offered by them. Next is the they protect the coastlines from cyclone, strong wave action, floods, sea level rise, greenhouse effect and coastal erosion. So how, friends, they will protect us? If they have so much so abundant growth of fruits, then obviously the cyclones or the waves that will come, the speed of these waves will be reduced. So in this way the waves will not affect with that much intensity in the coastal inland. So here also you may see the roots of these mangrove forests. So their roots are so much entangled. So when such roots will be there, then how can the sea water or the storm water can inundate in the coastal inlands? Because if the speed will obviously reduce by facing such obstruction. So they are helpful in preventing the coastal erosion and also from preventing the loss of property and life when the phenomena like tsunami takes place. So the habitat provides the breeding and the nursery grounds for many of the marine and terrestrial animals. They are ideal habitats for many terrestrial and marine species, carbon sinks, and they are also, friends, carbon sinks. Carbon sink, friend, means they are large absorbents of carbon. They absorb the carbon in them and trap it in themselves. So in a way, the carbon is reduced from the surrounding atmosphere. So they are carbon sinks. Also they are natural barriers against storm surges. So already I have explained you it in detail, and also they prevent coastal erosion. This also I have explained you. So here you can see the diagram. These are aerial roots, these are nematophores. So I earlier told you that the mangroves, where they grow, the soil is the saline conditions prevail, as well as anoxic conditions prevail. That means the dissolved oxygen is less. So in order to get oxygen and to adapt themselves to the saline conditions, these roots come out from beneath the surface of the land, and they absorb the oxygen from the surrounding atmosphere. So this is a unique adapting mechanism in them. And here also you can see these mangrove forests, entangled roots which impede the water flow. So this is all about mangroves. So friends, let's see the mangroves from Indian scenario. So this is very important, friends. You must know it that in India, where the mangrove forests are found. So friends, in West Bengal, the mangroves are most extensive. So if we consider the mangroves in India, the largest mangrove site is in West Bengal, and it is called सुंदरबन. तो फ्रेंड्स यू मस्ट रिमेंबर इट, इट इज इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम योर प्रीलिम्स पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. द लार्जेस्ट मैंग्रोव साइट इन इंडिया इज सुंदरबन. नेक्स्ट इज इन उड़ीसा कम्स द भितरकनिका, महानदी, सुबर्ण रेखा, धमड़ा, मैंग्रोव जेनेटिक रिसोर्स सेंटर, चिल्का. इन आंध्र प्रदेश कम्स द कोरिंगा, ईस्ट गोदावरी, कृष्णा, अंडमान निकोबार, नॉर्थ अंडमान निकोबार, तमिलनाडु, पिछावरम, मोठुपेट, रामपेट, रामनाथ, पुलिकट, कजनुवेली, वेम्बनाथ. इन केरला कम्स द वेम्बनाथ, कन्नूर, नॉर्थ केरला एंड कुंदापुर एंड दक्षिण कन्नड़, हनावर. एंड इन कर्नाटका कम्स द करवर, मैंगलोर फॉरेस्ट डिवीजन, गोवा कम्स गोवा, एंड ऑल दीज आर इन द महाराष्ट्र एंड ऑल दीज इन द गुजरात. सो फ्रेंड्स यू डोंट हैव टू रिमेंबर दिस ब्रेकेज ऑफ दीज दिस सॉरी फ्रेंड्स दीज माइनर साइट्स. यू जस्ट हैव टू रिमेंबर द मैक्रो पिक्चर. So here you can see, you must remember that the examiner can ask about the major reasons where the mangroves are found. For example, the West Bengal, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh. Here you can remember the Sundarban, which is the largest site. Other sites you don't have to remember. So here you can see the diagram. So I have included it. Just remember, here are the Sundarbans. And here also, friends, one more thing I want to tell you, that after Sundarbans, which is the largest site for the mangroves, comes the Gujarat, which is at the second number. And next is the also here the Andaman Nicobar, which is shown not shown in the map. So you can see this map for it will be easy to remember. West Bengal, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, they are also found in Kerala, Goa, and this Goa and Maharashtra and Gujarat. So these are all about, this is all about mangroves. Next, friends, comes the threats to mangroves. So, what are the threats to mangroves? Friends, the threats to the mangrove are of two types. That is natural and anthropogenic. Natural is from the nature and anthropogenic is from the human beings. So these factors may affect the system as a whole. They might affect the entire mangrove, or they might disturb one entity within the system. So the natural threats include the climate change, that is that sea levels are increasing, cyclones, which can affect these mangroves and the physical processes. And the anthropogenic processes comes, anthropogenic processes includes diseases, deterioration, pollution, grazing, agriculture, aquaculture, human encroachment, including reclamation. And all these are considered anthropogenic threats. Poorly planned human settlements, improper location of industries and infrastructure, which pollute these sites, pollution from industries and settlements, over-exploitation of living natural resources like wood and over-exploiting the wood, or cutting the mangroves, deforestation for domestic purposes, for domestic needs, inadequate institutional capacities which are not providing a focused attention to prevent the degradation of these mangroves. Next is the lack of participation of local communities. Local communities are not participating in the formulation as well as implementation of coastal management plans. It is a fact, friends, that the local communities not only are not participating, but they are contributing to the devastation of these mangroves. Why, friends? Because they are using them for using the wood for their domestic purposes. They are cutting them down for their own personal needs. So all these things are to be reduced. The awareness among the people must be generated that it is their loss. It would pose a threat to their life and property if in future any disaster takes place like tsunami. So all these things, institutional focus must be there, like institutional capacities must be built up, capacity building must take place. So all these steps need to be taken to prevent the degradation of mangroves. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you liked my lecture, then please like it. If you didn't like it, then please tell me how can I improve it to meet your needs. So friends, this is our Telegram channel. You can join it. All the latest initiatives that we are running on YouTube or on any other platform, we communicate with you on this channel. So if you want to remain in touch with our initiatives on different platforms, or you want to stay tuned with us, then you can join, you must join this Telegram channel, because it will be beneficial to you. And friends, please share my video with your friends if you liked it. And one last thing, if you want to subscribe to the notes of these daily video discussions, you can WhatsApp us at this number 8968426481. So friends, ultimately why subscribing to the notes is important, because at the end of the day you can't see the whole video or you can't see a complete book. You just have to rely on the notes. So either you make your own notes and waste your time, or we do this job for you. So in order to save your time, we have made this job easy for you. We have prepared you for the notes for you people. So in order to subscribe to these notes, you can WhatsApp us at this number. We will subscribe to you these we will subscribe to you with these daily PDFs after some procedure. So this is all about today's lecture, friends. Thank you, friends. Thank you.